Hi, everybody. I'm supposed to be waiting for the countdown, I think. Am I right? Oh, no, I'm so sorry. I'm so relaxed. It was great hanging out with everybody all day long. So this is why you're getting me the way you are. So I'm going to talk today about teachability. And if you don't know what that is, I hope that I can explain it. First of all, I'd like to tell you why I have like a rainbow behind me of boxes and bubbles. Well, it's kind of the way I think of education. It's quite colorful, it's not black and white, and you can have some standards which get stuck in boxes, and you have bubbles that are kind of emerging out of it. So let's go into that wonderland a little bit. The focus of today was to figure out a switch. And for me, the switch that I wanted to focus on is between a teacher and a student, and the student and the teacher. So this kind of dynamic is something that I live with all the time, since for the past 20 years I've been a teacher in higher education, and for the past 10 years I've been a student getting my PhD. So what is teachability about? Well, teachable is a word from 1917. So it's over 100 years old, and it actually means the apt or willingness to learn, but it's focused on the student. And I want to flip that out a little bit because we're seeing more and more people go and pursue a higher education. And when they're doing that, as you see the statistics, in 2000 there were 100 million. And now there's 207 million, those are the latest statistics, pursuing higher education. But I wonder how many teachable moments there are. So while we know that the quantity of those pursuing a higher degree is increasing, what are they learning? What are they taking away? What are they remembering? So how do I define this? I make it that the teachers and students are equally accountable. So the teachers, to have teachability, they have to be open to learning as they teach. And students equally have the ability to be open to learning. So I'll go back a little bit in my story, and as you will see throughout my slides, I organize it with a few original pictures that come from my own personal collection and some collages that I made. So what you'll experience, hopefully, is both content and style. So here we go a little bit back on what triggered me to think about teachability. Well, at the end of last year, I was kind of finding myself in a crisis. I was doing what I always do, which is filling my plate so full with a lot of activities, a lot of responsibilities, coaching, mentoring, teaching, mothering, wifing, friending, lots of things. And here's an example of an angel arriving at my doorstep. So just when I'm feeling overburdened, overworked, one of my former students from 19 years ago arrives at the doorstep to rescue me. He says, "I'd like to come and talk to your students." There's nothing that makes a teacher happier than a student remembering her or him and coming back into the classroom to share on to the next generation. This student won't mind that I mention his name. His name is Renato. He sat in the center of the picture, and he just was named Huffington Post a number one entrepreneur to watch. So having that kind of person come back into the classroom and talk about his experience. Now, I don't think I was his favorite teacher, nor do I credit him as being my favorite student. But what we definitely shared were teachable moments. And this is what you remember after time lapses. So that's me with my students. What about me as a student with my teachers? So you go to a classroom and you learn from your teachers. But in a PhD, you're a lot of the time alone with books, or you go to conferences and you connect with people and you try to understand the material. This is me swimming at the bottom of the picture, swimming like underwater. And that's how sometimes it feels when you're studying. You get so bogged down with facts and information and trying to figure it out The only thing that can help you is a couple teas and coffees with some people willing to hear you out and listen to it. So imagine at the same time, I'm teaching, and I'm studying, and I'm creating my PhD, and it's almost done after 10 years, and my memory goes to a throwback. And this throwback goes to when I was in college. Now you're seeing a picture of a cheerleader up there. I know I might not look like one, but I was. And I was doing lots of other things. So one day, I approached the elevator in my building at the campus, 13,000 students where I was going, and you know, hundreds of teachers, and one happened to be waiting with me all alone in the elevator, you know, waiting for the elevator. You know what that's like, right? You're like, should we talk, shouldn't we talk? Anyway, he starts to talk to me, and he says, "Hey, Tina, I see that you're a cheerleader," and I start to fill with pride. "Yes, I am." And then he says, "And I think I've seen you around campus working like two jobs, right?" And I'm like, "Yes," and I'm filling with pride. And then he says, "And you have a full course load right now, don't you?" And I said, "Yes," filling with pride. But what does Rudy say back to me? "You're doing too much. If you try to do too much, you'll get nothing done." Huh. I sat there and I smiled like a cheerleader and I said, "He doesn't know me. He doesn't know me. He just doesn't know how much I can do. So I'll show him." But why did I think about this after I was doing teaching and PhD and all the other things? Because after about 30 years, I finally stopped hating him. Because I knew what he was trying to say. So that was my teachable moment. It just took such a long time for me to realize what he was getting at. So, what does that mean to me today, and what should that mean to you? Well, why does anyone try to go to this teaching exchange, this learning exchange with anyone? It's so that you see a different view, that you maybe share some different emotions, that you share ideas, that you share values, and that in the end, you get something new of value out of that. And the way I can tell you how we'll pack the rest of the talk is, I think I found some ways that you can look at how you switch between perspectives, and maybe you'll realize that you had more teachable moments than you have. So right now, just pause for a moment and think about that teacher who saw that ultimate potential in you before you even saw it. It's making me cry. And thank them a little bit inside of yourself. Now, maybe you're not like me, maybe you're not bitter and hold on to something for 30 years, but think about maybe someone who underestimated you, and maybe you said, "I'll show them," and how much that fueled you. Because sometimes your teachable moments aren't always going to be positive. They might be negative to start before you realize what they were meant to be. And I find that happens. So there's five different areas, I think, of switching roles and perspectives that we can take away. First of all, there's the novice or an expert. When you are looking at the teacher and the student, maybe you're thinking simply, the teacher is the expert and the student is the novice. And that means the teacher's here and the student's here, or the teacher's here and the student's down there. But that's not how I see it exactly now in hindsight. I see so much joy and pleasure in the learning process. And I love to see students stumbling around with new information, fiddling with it, and trying to experiment and just go for it. And they come up with very surprising ways to look at material and instances that I've been looking at for decades. Now, so if I'm supposed to be the expert, but I take this pleasure in the student going around, that lets me let go of something else that experts have, which is called ego. We all have ego. but it helps us stay in a box and not see things from a new perspective. So we need to embrace that. So this is just you'll see pictures of my students in here, and I don't mean to say that they endorse me. What I'm trying to say, it's from my personal collection, and I will try not to invade any of their privacy by telling any of their stories, but just my perspective, and they're just for the background. So we'll go back one step. The students in this picture experience a classroom where we flip that novice and expert. Usually you start with a book. We ended with a book. So they didn't start with a book for the course, but they wrote content that was enough to fill a book at the end. Diverse versus similar. This is the switch. How many times do you, in working groups, in school, and then later on in teams, do you spend trying to be with people that are similar to you? Probably very often. But what we need to strive for is not always being attracted and going to the easy path, but sometimes trying to embrace people who aren't like us at all. The people who give us tension and that we may argue with a little bit. Not too much, but to give us a different perspective. So here's a student group that I taught. And you're probably looking at them for the diversity of where they've come from. And I look at this picture at also the similarity of where they grew together, and then also how different their paths will be afterwards. So diversity can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Gender, age, income, lots of variables of where their desires go and what their personalities are like. So embrace that. When I walk into a classroom, I look around the room, just like I'm looking around here, and sometimes there are people who won't come forward. They don't want to be seen. They hide in the crowd. And sometimes that helps them to just blend in. But I try to look and see, and if students are not open, then that makes it really, really hard to have the communication necessary for more teachable moments to happen. So this is one exercise we did in a class where the students had to do a very simple activity. The simple activity was this: challenge. Take an idea that you have and turn it into 3D. Now, wasn't a lot of points at all. It was just that everybody else had to do it too. And we had prototype day. So you can see from this small collection of students that some went and expressed themselves so much in the type of model they created, and others used very simple objects and great storytelling skills. So you really couldn't hide in this situation. You had to come out. Number four, truth and lies. So maybe you tell yourself that you're working really hard as a student, or you're working really hard as a teacher. But does that mean you're doing a standard that is going to have you stand out? Or are you kidding yourself? We do this all the time to cope. We do many times the minimum, but we want the maximum results. I was raised pretty tough with this: good, better, best. I will never let it rest till my good is better and my better is best. Whoa, that's a hard standard to compete with because you're always trying to up. So over time, I've had to learn the benefits of trying to just get the minimum done and the maximum results. So this is a switch too. It's think about questioning the answers you give yourself all the time and answering the questions that you pose. This is a scene of students where I challenge them to use a box to create stories, and it was very important to take this opportunity to connect with others. But there's always sometimes some resistance. What are we doing out on the lawn? Why aren't we in the classroom thinking out of the box? So the thing is, where are those points where you think that it's worth it to risk being yourself in front of everybody. Last one is follow and leader. So I've been teaching for a long time, and what I noticed was there's a little bit of pattern going back to diversity that I couldn't get girls and boys to be on the same team. And so I started to know that the research was also saying that diverse teams produce the best results. So I started requiring girls and boys to be on teams together. Since girls were in the minority, I also made them be the team leader. What happened was girls were crying, I need to be with my best friend, and I didn't take any mercy, and I made them still lead. What happened was this scenario that the girl who was the follower in the group of her friends, she got a 5 or the best grade to lead a new team. She just needed that opportunity to do that. And this scene, unrelated, is just a scenario where the first day of class, we started to try to build teams, and you can see men rose to the leadership of the ship in the room, and the girls were sitting there. So I ask you to think about switching leadership roles a little bit. So in the end, teachability requires both teachers and students to be open to learning process, learning from each other throughout. And I can say that the mind is not a vessel to be filled, but a fire to be kindled. And this is really from a classroom. So I thank you very much for your time. And the idea today is to have more teachable moments. #BeOpenToLearn. Thank you very much.